What's up, everybody, and welcome to episode 17 of Rogue Agent Radio, your place for all things Tom Clancy's The Division and the number one fan podcast for The Division. I'm one of your hosts, Boomslang, and joining me, as always, is the master of management, Deep Fried Dave. How you doing today, Dave?
Couldn't be better. Today is one of the greatest American holidays, Super Bowl Sunday. So I am already preparing, got some wings ready to smoke for tonight's game, and then also doing some bacon-wrapped jalapenos stuffed with cheese and sausage.
One of these days, I want to go to a Super Bowl party at your house. I think that would be one of the most delicious things I've ever done.
The party itself at my house is no longer a party. It's me trying to keep the kids away for 2 hours while I watch a football game. So yeah. Back in the old day, a party was something else.
Right. And finally, we have the rock star of gaming, Blessed Doom. How you doing today, Doom?
Pretty good. I didn't even realize that the Super Bowl was today until yesterday.
Well, you're not into sport ball, so...
No, I'm not a sport ball guy.
I'm not a big fan of the NFL. I used to be a really big fan of it, and everyone's going to hate me after this, and like the podcast is going to end and crash and burn, but I'm actually a Patriots fan, so I was sad that they lost, but I didn't really care. I mean, I don't care anymore. I used to be a really big fan. With us, we have a very special guest. We have Alex from Arekkz Gaming. How are you doing today? Thanks for joining us.
I'm good. I am very good. Thank you. Yeah, thank you for having me. So it's good to be here. Yeah. I unfortunately know nothing about Super Bowl coming from across the pond. But yes, thank you for having me. It's good. Yeah. It's good to be here finally.
What do they play over there? Cricket and rugby and things like that?
yeah, I guess cricket. I mean, I'm not really a sports person, but yeah. I guess cricket and our football is football and not soccer.
Right. Yeah. The real football, yeah. not the throw ball.
Yeah, the real football. Exactly. Yeah. But then I don't really support it. So, you know, you guys can have football. Right. Yeah. Just I'm all about that esports life.
Cool. Yeah, definitely. So, Alex, tell us who are you exactly? What do you do for those who might not know exactly? I'm sure if anyone's ever searched like the Division videos, then they've definitely run across you. But for those who just listen to podcasts and don't have like a computer or something, if they're like that,
they live under a rock.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So what do you do exactly?
So my name's Alex or Arekkz, and I am primarily a YouTuber. I've been doing YouTube for about 3 years now. I made the jump to go full-time beginning of last year. Cover sort of like pretty much all games, but the way that we run the channel is we have like a few staple titles, mm-hmm. one of which is Destiny, one is Division, and one is Monster Hunter. So they are basically titles that produce video content for every single week regardless, whereas other games, you know, we kind of tend to cover when there are big releases. So, you know, right. for example, if a new game just comes out, we'll cover it. But the main titles, things like Division, are the ones where every single week you can log on or check into the channel and there'll be video content for you. Right. And then this year, or like halfway through last year, we started sort of jumping onto Twitch as well. So that's it's a new venture for us. But yeah, primarily YouTube is where it's at. If you want like, you know, information, guides, tips, breakdowns, anything like that, then we got you covered.
Yeah, it seems like it'd be a lot of work because you do seem to cover like every big game that comes out. And I see that, I'm like, man, you know, even with the few videos that I do, it's like, I can't imagine how much work goes into making content for every single one of those titles that releases. It's impressive.
Yeah, it's. I mean, it gets a bit insane. It's nice because it's one of those things where it'll make me play games that I wouldn't necessarily normally play. I mean, I would never like cover a game that I don't like. But at the same time, if there are games that say, you know, it might come out, and I think to myself, you know, I might play it, but I might not have too much time. But if there's interest in it, and I actually go and make videos for it, then it gives me a chance to play it. So it's nice from that perspective. But I think the difficult part is that when you cover games like Destiny, Division, and Monster Hunter, because I cover them week in, week out. You know, I know them inside out, which is great because if I'm doing video content, it's, you know, easy to like sound informed and stuff. But if you're covering, say, a game that someone maybe has asked you to cover and you don't really know too much about it, then everyone, as I'm sure you can imagine, everyone on the internet expects you to be good at all the games.
Right. Yeah.
It's all right to be good at games that you play all the time, but if suddenly you pick up a game and you're not like that, like I'll give the example recently was Fallout. Like, I've never really been into Fallout, but I tried to get into Fallout 4 because people were like, you need to play this. So I was like, you know what, I'll give it a try. And then all the Fallout fans were like, you're playing it wrong, you're doing it all wrong, you haven't done this, you haven't done that. I'm like, you know what, I'm out. I'm done. Yeah. So, but no, it's good. It's good fun. It's a lot of work, but it's kind of something I'm used to because I came from, because before I went full-time YouTube, I used to work at Microsoft. Mm. And I did some, well, the first couple of years I did testing and then I moved over to be producer on, there's a video platform on Xbox One called Upload.
Oh, yeah.
And I basically made video content for them. So it was effectively like being a YouTuber for Xbox and then coming home and being a YouTuber for myself. Right. So I kind of got into this life of making non-stop video content. So then when I just went full-time, it ended up just being, you know, not so bad. So, yeah.
Right, yeah, that's cool. So that's kind of where you got your start in YouTube. Like, where did you, like, begin your whole content creation journey?
Well, the beginning of the journey really starts with, because I run my channel with my friend 269, and he's kind of like the starting point, because when we used to work together in Microsoft, he was like, you know what, we should just launch a YouTube channel and, you know, just start. We didn't really have, like, too much direction to begin with, so we used to upload, like, raw gameplay, some trailers and stuff, and just, you know, kind of whatever we wanted to do. And then as it started to sort of grow, like, the first year, I wasn't really sure. I was still kind of, like, finding my feet, and if I go back and look at any of my original videos, I just cringe, because it's just, you look at, like, how far you've come. But, yes, the first, yeah, exactly. So the first year, you know, kind of sort of, like, pushing it that way. But then when I made the switch and jumped over to upload and started sort of, like, you know, producing a lot more content, especially for, you know, for Xbox and Microsoft, it started to give me slightly better appreciation and, like, a slightly better understanding. And I think really the turning point for myself on the channel was probably Destiny, because up until then I always used to cover all big releases, but I could never stick at a game. After about a week or two, I get bored.
Yeah.
And that's, of course, difficult on YouTube, because if you're reliant on games coming out and there's no games coming out, it's a bit like, what do you do? So Destiny came out. It was the first game I ever managed to do daily and continual content for, basically since Destiny launched.
Yeah,
there's been pretty much daily content on the channel, albeit apart from, like, recently. So yeah, that's kind of like the sort of the turning point. But yeah, it's always been like, you know, I run it with my friends. So 269 does a lot of stuff behind the scenes. He's more like analytics, social media management, and all the kind of like planning and stuff we do, and then I kind of produce content.
Oh, that's really cool. Yeah, it's nice how games are coming out nowadays, like, unless you're playing, like, World of Warcraft or something, you know, like the new games that are kind of that MMO-ish style, they allow you to make stuff every single day. And that's what's exciting about The Division, is because I can see that being the exact same. You know, there's going to be so much stuff to talk about. Like, even with the podcast, you know, we're going over, like, talents, and now we're going to go over perks here in a minute. But there's, like, constantly stuff to talk about. Like, I can think of, like, 20 episodes that we could do from now, you know, into the next few weeks, which is really exciting. And it's funny how you mentioned, like, you go back and listen to the first videos or whatever and you cringe. It's the same way with this podcast. We go back to listen to episode one, I'm like, oh, that was rough. That was really rough. Or I go back and listen to some of my first videos I ever put on YouTube, I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm just gonna put that under private. No one needs to see that. But yeah, I've done that a couple times. What are some good tips? And this, you know, speaking to me too, like, what are some tips for people who might want to, like, get started in YouTube? Because it's funny, because people come to me and like, I've had people comment on my videos or whatever, and I don't really know what to tell them. They're like, oh, how'd you get so successful on YouTube? I'm like, I'm not, so I don't really know what to say. Like, what would be some tips that you would give people, like, when they're first starting out?
I mean, I suppose a couple of things I always say to everyone that always starts out is, the most important thing is, you need to know that it takes a very long time. There are a lot of people that I know have started channels and they've come to me and they're like, you know, why have I still got no traction, or why have I got no views? And you kind of need to understand, in your very first year of YouTube, you know, your first few videos will get 10 views, will get 50 views. And, you know, if you're pushing 100 views on like your first few videos, you're doing well.
Right.
People need to realize that in your first year, you know, if you can hit 1,000 subscribers in your first year, you know, you're doing great. But in all honesty, you look at someone like the big guys, I mean, like, there have been interviews when you speak to people like Ali A and stuff, and, you know, they talk about how, you look at how big they are now, but they say in their first year, you know, they got like 1,000 subscribers, the second year 2,000. So it's a very, very long process. But I think a lot of people, when they see, you know, their favorite YouTuber and they see what they're doing and they want to replicate that, they then suddenly put their heart and soul into videos, upload them, and then nobody can see them.
Right.
Because, of course, there's a lot, you know, it's not quite as simple as uploading a video and having the whole world see it. There's a load of stuff that goes on behind the scenes, and that's stuff that people need to learn. But ultimately, it's all about consistency. You know, if you want to do it, and if you're doing it for the right reasons, you know, there's, like, I enjoy making content, and that's, you know, that's why I do it all the time. You know, I couldn't do it if I didn't like making videos.
Right.
You know, I couldn't just do it every single day. But a lot of people, you know, they either do it because they want to be, you know, they if they're doing it for the wrong reason, they're not going to grow anyway, because they're going to get impatient and they're going to lose motivation. But if you're doing it for the right reason, then you've just got to stick at it. Like, you've got to have constant content, because it doesn't necessarily have to be daily, but I do say you need to have some kind of regular cadence. Your subscribers need to know that, all right, if I come back on a Monday and a Wednesday, I know you'll have new videos.
Right.
So then at least that way they can start to understand, because anything like online, is people are slow to pick things up, but, you know, they'll always, like, if you can kind of do something right regularly enough, people will start to cotton on. You know, I know people that, one of my friends recently, actually, you know, he spent the first year kind of building his channel. He wasn't really sure where he wanted to go. Like, he couldn't really sort of find his direction. And then Star Wars Battlefront came out, and he suddenly started to kind of basically becoming like a Star Wars Battlefront YouTuber. And it clicked with him, because he really enjoys it. And suddenly he just hit 10,000 subscribers recently.
Nice.
So yeah, it's just all about, it's about finding your place, finding, you know, what you're doing. If you're doing it for the right reasons as well, you know, if you're genuine and you're passionate about it, people will like that and they'll, you know, they'll catch on. It's just, but yeah, it's a slow grind. It's, it will not happen overnight. It won't happen over a month. It will happen over like 2-3 years. So.
Right. I can definitely, definitely second that, because I think, this February, sometime this year will be like the 1 year mark of when I uploaded my very first video. And it was just that first day I was like, you know what? I'm just going to do it. I'm just going to start talking about this. You know, The Division was like my first official video that I started talking about. Okay. So I was, you know, just like,
oh, you've done really well for a first year then.
Yeah, I it's incredible. Like the response and the support has been amazing. It's been really cool. I love, you know, talking to everyone in my comments. A lot of times I'll just spend like an hour and just go through and try to comment on all of the legitimate ones, the ones that are just troll. I'll just put like LOL and just keep going. You know?
Yeah.
It's kind of funny, but it's funny, you know, like I actually get trolls now, which I'm like, hey, and, you know, that's a bad sign, but it's a good sign too. You know, at least, you know, the word's getting out. So.
I know you made it.
Yeah. I'm hitting the big time. I've got trolls now, but yeah, definitely just, doing it for, like you said, doing it for the right reasons and enjoying it. Like that's the only reason I do it. I enjoy it. Like,
yeah.
I remember I made my one video that has like the most views out of all of them, and I put a ton of effort into. And then people were like, "Oh, you can definitely tell this is a financially influenced opinion." And I'm like, "Really?" I was like, "If I could just show you my analytics right now, you could see it's not. Yeah, it's not a financially influenced."
It's crazy.
Opinion.
The amount of people that say that is. I mean, like. Even when I've been recently, if I cover like a different game, if people are used to me covering a certain game and like, oh, like when I did a video for Unravel and everyone's like, oh, this is clearly sponsored. It's like, it's actually not. It's like, if EA wanted to pay big bucks, that's fair enough. But it's like, really, I just like playing games.
Right.
But I think when you kind of like, when you make videos often enough, I think people kind of, I think there's a certain expectation. They kind of feel like YouTubers have to be like the mouthpiece. So, you know, if they've got any like negativity. So like, for example, when I went to the event in Malmo and I came back and I had nothing but positive stuff to say. It wasn't because I was afraid to say anything bad, but it's because I honestly had 3 hours with the game.
Right.
And in that time, I was so excited that I just didn't, in 3 hours, I didn't really see any negatives because I was just like enjoying every moment of it. If I played for like 50 hours, like this is what I say to a lot of people, they're like, you know, you don't really complain about The Division. I'm like, because right now, even in the beta, you know, the beta was a very small section of the game. And I've played, you know, I invested 60 hours into the beta, but the point is, it's still, I've only seen like a very kind of small section of the game. So until the full game comes out, once I've then invested 50, 60, 100 hours in the full game, yeah, maybe then I'll have my complaints about certain aspects of it.
Exactly.
But right now, you know, so then people then respond with that and they're like, you know, oh, you're being paid for this, or Ubisoft, you know, you don't want to say anything bad. It's like, well, really, it's just because, like, I spent so long, you know, when I was a game tester, like, you know, you spend so long being hypercritical over games, it almost kind of ruins games for you. So like, as a YouTuber, I like to just enjoy what I'm doing. So I you know, if there's something that's ultimately negative, I could either just make a video talking about something really, really bad, but why do you want to hear me complain?
Right.
Or just talk about something I enjoy.
Yeah,
so,
exactly. It's funny how that kind of mentality is all across the internet. Like, if you can't be positive about a game, I don't know why people think that is. It's like, why you want to be mad at everything? But
yeah,
let's go ahead and move into The Division. Like, what is your overall impression so far from what you've played? Like, why do you like it, and if there are anything or any things that you think need to be improved, like what's your just overall impression of it so far?
I am super impressed so far. I mean, it's honestly, like, even from when I played the alpha before, when we weren't necessarily allowed to talk about the alpha, but it was just, for when I played over, you know, 3 days, it's probably the best gaming experience I've had in maybe the last like 2 years. And I've played a lot of games, but it's just, it combines so many aspects of things that I like. I mean, firstly, it's third person, which is, I've always preferred third person over first person just because I like to see my character.
Yeah.
And you can also look around corners, which is kind of cheap, but
yeah.
It works for me. And it's also like, I mean, it's got that side of it. It's got the, you know, cosmetic side, which is a really cool thing because I've played so many games where, you know, you play World of Warcraft where you get some new high level gear, which is better than your old gear.
Right.
And then you have to take off the good looking gear. So you've got like the whole appearance stuff. Plus you've got all, you know, all the kind of the skills, the RNG system. Like, I'm, you know, basically the three games that I cover as staples, Division, Destiny, and Monster Hunter, all have RNG loot-based systems. So I think that's kind of what like hooks me in.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I mean, it's just like, there's just so many different aspects, you know, to the game, but like everything about it is just, you know, I've just been super impressed. Like, the Dark Zone is probably my all-time favorite thing because I used to play, when I used to play World of Warcraft, I used to play at a PvP server.
Mm-hmm.
So I remember one of the first things that happened was, you know, after the alpha and after the beta, there were a lot of like mixed opinions on Reddit with, for a lot of people that are like, you know, oh, I think the Dark Zone needs to be changed. This, you know, I don't like being shot all the time. And I think a lot of people need to realize that, while I don't want the default answer to be, if you don't enjoy it, don't play it. But the people need to realize that any other game where you were going to go into active multiplayer, you would go to the menu, select multiplayer, and choose your mode.
Right.
In the Division, because you can simply walk into a multiplayer area, people forget this, and because the lines are so blurred, you know, like, yeah. you might have someone that's so used to, you know, they're in the open world shooting AI, and suddenly they walk through a door. Maybe they don't realize what they're doing, and then suddenly they're being shot by players, and their stuff's being taken.
Right. Yeah.
So, but because I spent all my time on World of Warcraft on a PvP server, I'm very used to the fact that I could be walking down, an Alliance person will come down, they'll kill me and kill me on the spot while I'm trying to complete my mission, and yeah. It's something I'm used to, because ultimately, once you get, you know, you start as the small fry and you're the one that gets killed. Then you go and level up and you become the big fish that goes around killing all the small fry. So it's just, I think the Dark Zone is probably where I'm going to spend a lot of my time. But
yeah, I love the dynamics. I love how you can go in there as a solo player or with a squad, and it changes how you play and how you interact with other people. Because like 9 times out of 10, when I was a solo player and I was trying to extract and there were 4 other guys around, they would shoot me because it was like, hey, I can just shoot this guy, you know, we're rogue level 1, and then extract and move on. So, you know, like, there's different strategies that you have to use as a as a solo player. But anyways, yeah, I'm definitely excited for it too. So
yeah,
but anyways, that's it's cool to know, you know, where you've come from and what you're doing and stuff. So I'm definitely excited about that. But anyways, let's go ahead and get some housekeeping for Rogue Agent Radio out of the way. In case you didn't know, Rogue Agent Radio is your base of operations for the Division news, information, game discussions, and agent trust issues. You can find us on iTunes by searching Rogue Agent Radio, and on Podbean if you use PC and Android, those things, where the show is posted every Monday morning. Subscribe, rate, review, tell your friends, all that good stuff. Also, check us out on our official website, rogueagentradio.com, where you can find the links to all of the podcast stuff and the hubs, social hubs such as Twitter and Facebook. You know the drill. So let's go ahead and begin episode 17 with the news of the week. Dave, take us away with the news of the week. What are we going to talk about?
First thing we're going to talk about is during the 1,000-hour stream that the Division had put together for the beta, one of the community managers, Yannick, had made a comment. I guess someone was in the chat and referenced the fact that weapon skins were a bit rare during the beta.
Just a little bit.
So he had mentioned that because they recognized the rarity of weapon skin drops, that they were going to add a weapon skin vendor. So kind of both sides of this, I'm going to say there's 2 different ways to look at this and a lot of feedback on the internet. So I want to see what you guys thought. Just kind of a little quick round table. Is this a good thing? Is this a bad thing? What's your opinion on it?
I hope they keep the weapon drops in the game, because it's fun, you know, once you do get one, you're like, oh my gosh, I got a weapon drop finally, you know. I think I only got 2 in the entire beta, and 1 was on PlayStation, 1 was on Xbox, so they weren't both on the same ones. But I think having a vendor could be kind of cool, maybe have them the cycle through. You know, I don't know. I just think that might open the door to microtransactions for it. And even though it's not, you know, it doesn't change the way the game is played, but I just don't want to see that happen. Other than that, I don't care. You know, as long as it's just like in-game money that you buy it with, you know, you go collect whatever. So
yeah, are there different rarity levels? Because I never did get a weapon skin. Are there different rarity levels to the skins?
No.
Or are they all pretty much the same?
I think they're all like this, that light blue color of all the cosmetic items.
Okay. What I thought would be cool is if there's only some that you can buy, and then there's some that only come from drops or high-level enemies.
That'd
yeah,
be cool.
I think because one of the problems you have with selling everything is that, because one of the nice things is, you know, I remember it was probably like the last day that I got my weapon skin finally, but every time I ran around the Dark Zone and, you know, we killed people or got killed by people, I see the gun on their back and I'm like, they've got a weapon skin, like, where did this come from? I even made a post on Reddit during the beta, like, where are you guys getting these skins from, because I really need one. And everyone was like, yeah, go and help civilians. So I then, honestly, I was up till about 4 a.m. walking around finding civilians. And every single time they gave me boots. And I'm like, oh. So I went to sleep, woke up the next day, and finally got one, which was great. But if they suddenly, on the flip side, because that's a really good feeling, because I had a really cool red one, and like I didn't see anyone else with it. But of course, if they suddenly have a vendor and you can buy them for like 200 in-game credits, then everyone's going to be rolling around with guns. And while it's not necessarily a problem, it is nice to have that, you know, because ultimately that's why... On the flip side of microtransactions, it's an interesting topic, but I'm always like on the side of cosmetic microtransactions, simply because I think if they're done well, you know, like not necessarily that I'm saying that they always should have them, but at the same time, if companies include them, I've never really been against cosmetic stuff because ultimately it boils down to if someone wants to spend some more money to make themselves look different, then that's, you know, that's their call. That's their, if they're throwing away their money or they're doing what they want to do, you know, because that's, you know, that's ultimately them because they're not buying power. They're not, it doesn't give them an advantage. It just means that they can walk around and say, you know what, I look slightly different to everyone else because I care about my cosmetic appearance.
Right.
You know, so I think, again, for like weapon skins, well, it could open that up. I think it's nice to have something that no one else has. Mm-hmm. But I think at the same time, it was also super frustrating how rare they were. So I think the balance for that would be, like you mentioned, have sort of some that you can find through drops. You know, like there'll be, you know, ultra rare ones, but then have like a base set that you can buy. So everyone that way could always have like, I don't know, because it's Division, let's say everyone can buy an orange weapon skin.
Right.
So then at least if you want some kind of customization, you can have it. And you can buy as many of those as you want, but it would be... But then at least there are some that, you know, maybe if you go into like the final mission, there's like a boss that drops a special one. And then that could be really cool.
Yeah, like solid colors. Like you could buy solid colors, like blue, red, green, white, or whatever. Exactly. And then in the game, and then in the world, you could have like camouflage and all these different crazy ones.
That'll work. Yeah, and also if you have like rotating vendors as well, because you've got every single like around the open world, and we didn't get it in the beta, but there's obviously safe houses as well, and they've got vendors in them. So it'd be almost kind of cool if like the base operations sold maybe two colors, and then like a base, like a safe house up in the top right hand corner of the map sells a special purple. So you almost have to like go around the map looking for vendors.
Right. Well, that could like foster like community coordination too. Be like, oh, I found this weapon skin here, and it's only there for 15 more minutes. Run and grab it. You know.
Yeah, exactly.
Because that's what we were doing in the beta. Even like Doom, he said, "Hey, there's a superior ACR," and I was like, "Where? Where is this thing?" And so I went and ran and grabbed it. I was like, "Oh, that's pretty cool how that works." You know, with the dynamic and just
That is really nice, especially if they do have the same. I think something they were. I wasn't sure whether this was intentional, but in the beta, you had like different instances. So your point of the ACR, you know, I did the same thing because I was looking for the classic M44, the superior one.
Yeah.
So I went every single day. I was cycling Dark Zone instances, and I think it would be nice if, like, for the full game, they all have like the same instance. Because of course, that community thing you're talking about is, if it would be nice if you can definitely say, you know, Dark Zone vendor bottom right has got this gun.
Right.
But of course, the way the game currently is, you know, a handful of people go there and get it, but the like a different group of people might go there and have something else because the instance swaps.
Right.
So provided they get that right, then that could be really good.
Yeah, I hope they get it all solid.
Well, great. I was just going to add, I thought it was interesting. It seemed like really quick reaction to that, don't you think? I mean, the betas, you know, we're like 2-3 days in the beta, and then on stream, you know, Nanik says, well, we understand that there's been a rarity in the drops. We're going to put in a weapon skin. And that seems pretty quick, like quick response to feedback, or is it too quick? I don't know. That's what I quite asked myself, you know, why would we just
I think it's
drop rate or what?
I think it's because it's a relatively low cost fix. Because the way to sort of give some like game dev insight on this side, the way when you get this close to launch, you kind of like need to weigh up low cost fixes, and you know, because at the moment where they're at right now, they're most likely in what they're called like content code and content complete. Code is basically where the game logic is locked. So all these people that are posting up feedback for, say, how they want the rogue system to change, ultimately, as much as they're going to put this feedback in, they're not going to change it because the rogue system is an underlying heavy part of the game, and any changes for that at this stage would be, you know, astronomical. So realistically, at this stage, this close to launch, because they're going to be going gold most likely in the next couple of weeks, they're only going to be doing bug fixes, super high priority issues, and maybe a few balancing things. But putting in, say, like a weapon skin vendor, or as you say, changing the drop rate, is a relatively low cost fix, and it's nice because it can respond to community feedback. You know, like one of the simple things from the alpha, I don't know if you remember that you used to have to hold down Y to swap weapons.
Yeah.
Whereas now it's a double tap.
Double tap.
Holding down Y was a bit temperamental. So again, that's a relatively low cost fix, and it shows straight away that like someone has actively said in the community, this is an issue, and they're like, all right, we fixed it. So again, for like weapon skins, everyone's like, this is really annoying, I haven't got a weapon skin. And already before the game comes out, they're like, we'll give you a solution for that.
Right.
But on the flip side, they couldn't then turn around and say, oh, you know, I don't like the rogue system. We're like, all right, we'll reinvent our game, because it's just not
Let's just rebuild it. Scrap it all.
Yeah.
I do so, like those, like, that, I mean, this is encouraging to know that they are listening. Like they've changed so many things, and like there's a lot of things like I can't even tell people that they've changed. But like what the few major things that they've added was proximity chat and being able to aim down the sight. Like those didn't exist before E3.
And melee as well, yeah.
Yeah, and melee. And so those three, yeah, those are the three. I was, Melee was always the one I could never remember. Like, there's three things they added. I can't remember what that third one, but Melee, yeah. Those three things they added. So it's really cool to know that they're listening.
Yeah. And that's, and technically, I think that's a stealth takedown in the Dark Zone. I think that's one right there. The Melee is actually the stealth takedown that everybody's been looking for in the Dark Zone when you just whack the guy at the last one.
So, yeah. Save those bullets.
Yeah, exactly. All right, so let's thanks to Marco. Let's talk about map size again. I'll put a link in the show notes, but if you haven't gotten a chance to see this video, I think it's a great video, and I'm on board with it. And it's probably a touchy subject again, and it's probably, he mentioned his video is not going to get 100% good feedback because it is hard to get your head wrapped around. But if you don't know, if you haven't watched a lot of Marco's videos, he's very analytical and mathematical in a lot of things that he does.
Very numbers based.
Yeah, very numbers based. Very factual based on that. So what he's done is he's taken a few maps and trying to re-gauge the size of the division's map because it's obviously a hot topic. So now playing it for a while and being able to experiment with some things and actually talk about these things, he used his character in game to walk 200 meters. And was able to kind of pinpoint that in length on the map. So he has a measurement for 200 meters in the game itself, on the map itself. So then he could take that length and just pull it out by size all the way across to get a total number of meters of the map. So he did the same thing. He mentioned he did the same thing in Grand Theft Auto, which I agree that it's kind of hard to do when you have vehicles and so on and so forth. It really wasn't going to line up one-to-one. So he did the same thing in Fallout. So it goes into Fallout 4, uses the same technique, ends up doing, figuring out exactly how far 200 meters is on the map, and then multiplies that 200 meters out to get the size of that map. And once he's done doing that, they look like they're almost the same size identically, Fallout 4 map and the Division map. Mm. Knowing that the Division is more dense, but there's obviously not shy for things to do in Fallout 4. If you guys got a chance to see this, do you think that's accurate? I mean, it looks to me, I'm on board with the theory. I know it's kind of hard to get your head around, but I'm on board with it. The way that he did it, I think he's done the research, and I can't do anything to disprove it right now.
I haven't watched it, but personally, I don't really care, about comparing map sizes and things like that. Like, I have fun with it, and I explore just about every single part of the beta that I thought I did. I still didn't find everything, and I played the beta, for like 40 hours or something like that. So, it's cool to have this, map size or whatever, but I'm just going to wait for the full game, and then I'll run around the map or whatever. Like, it just doesn't interest me that much about the whole trying to figure out how big the map is, trying to figure out how much the content is and stuff. I don't know. Like, I normally steer clear from that because I just feel like it causes a lot of, I don't know. I see a lot of people raging about stuff like that. I don't know. It just kind of rubs me.
Well, I think he's trying to solve the rage, is what his point.
Yeah.
Was, I've seen the video. I think it's definitely, he makes some really, really good points. Because I think one of the problems with this, or with when people see this map, is that because they were sort of like, if you look back at like the original 2013 map that had Brooklyn, that had Manhattan, and also when you look at basically all of Manhattan, it looks like, if you look at that in general sort of like game terms, like you look at something like GTA and you think about how quickly you can get across a city, like the concept of being in a city, it's never really realized in a very realistic manner. You think about how, GTA, you can cross the city in 2, 3, 4 minutes.
Right.
But you look at somewhere like, if you were actually trying to get from like one side of New York to the other, think about how really long it would take you in real life. So I think the interesting thing to think is that, Division is super dense and it's as close as they're going to get to a one-to-one, sort of like replica. And when you think about like how long it just sort of like, even in the beta environment, just trying to get from sort of, the base of operations to the Dark Zone, it still took a fair few minutes. So I think it's going to be, just because if people look at it as a top-down map, when you pull it out and you see there's like this tiny section of Manhattan that's just basically cut out and they're like, this is the game map, everyone's like, well, that's tiny. I mean, that would surely just shrink into like the size of a house in GTA, but in realistic terms, into actual sort of like scale terms, because it's so because it's so dense and because they've tried to sort of like do this one-to-one replica, it's just a lot bigger than people actually see. It's just like, I think the actual, it's almost like the in-game map kind of gives the actual game world, does like the actual game world a disservice, because the in-game map makes it look smaller.
It really does. Fact,
it's not. Yeah.
Yeah, people are like, is this map going to be big enough? And I'm like, it's bigger than what you think it is. You
know? Yeah.
Because I ran from one side to the, like sprinted from one side to the other. And I was like, holy crap, this is a lot bigger than I thought it was. You know, because like you were saying, I think it does kind of, you know, it skews the actual size of the map when you zoom out, because like you're saying, it doesn't look that big when you zoom all the way out. But then if you zoom all the way in and realize, hey, this building takes, you know, 10 seconds to pass, and you're zoomed all the way in. It, I don't know. It is, yeah, it's interesting. That's a good point, though.
And the other thing you need to think about as well is that not only, I mean, in the Dark Zone, we had two zones. There's going to be six zones. So the Dark Zone itself was already pretty big anyway. Mm-hmm. So having that times three, but also you need to factor in as well the fact that, sure, not every single building, and I wouldn't even say it go as far as say most buildings are accessible. It's more like some buildings. But the point is, not only do you have some buildings that you can go in and up, but there's also a whole underground network below the game. So you've basically got, take the size of the Division, you know, height and width ways, and then raise and lower it in like a Z coordinate. You know, you've got below and above. Like suddenly you've got three of those maps stacked on top of each other effectively. Right.
Yeah, so, which I love. Yeah, I love the how dense the map is, how like every street corner has something different. And like you're saying, the underground, like you go down in the subway and you get lost almost. You're like, where in the world am I? And you find like, I went down the subway and found like a whole, like people were camping down there. And it's like a whole little like colony. I was like, wow, this is really cool.
Yeah, super good.
Yep. So the next thing, Ubisoft put out a new kind of, I would say promotional, but educational promotional video this week called Know Your Skills. Mm-hmm. So a lot of information there. If you're new to the Division, it's a really cool video. It's still a really cool video either way, but they show a lot of the skills that we have seen before or that we have played with before, actually. You know, the Pulse, the Seeker Mine, and the Ballistic Shield. But a couple things that we really hadn't seen before, and you two can correct me if I'm wrong, but we had seen some cinematic footage from the shopping mall, even though you really couldn't tell, at least I couldn't tell it was from the shopping mall when I initially looked at it. But now they did show a lot of gameplay in this inside a shopping mall, which I thought was really cool. And I always thought it would be a really cool experience to have some gunfights inside of a shopping mall like that. And then one of the other things that they showed is they showed in gameplay how the mobile cover works. So it's like for the security tree, so you'll throw this shield down and it'll, you know, raise itself up as a barrier to get behind. And I think the one that they had the extension skill mod on it, so it kind of spanned it out a little bit so you and your teammates could get behind it. But the one thing that was cool, which I didn't think of, is you could actually attach a turret to the top of it. It had like a spot to attach the turret.
Yeah.
So what they were showing in the video is the mod going down, it gets extended. Someone attaches their turret on the top of it, which the extension allows you to get behind cover, or more than one person to get behind this cover. And then another person on your squad can then activate one of their skills, Smart Cover, which then enhances the cover that somebody else put down to give you more damage and reduce damage, incoming damage. So I think when people watch that, they just have to kind of start thinking about all the different things that you can do as a team together. And that one little instance like that was really cool to see.
It was
really cool to see that.
It was very exciting. It's very Borderlands 1. You had something real similar to that where you could set up a turret and it had a shield and everybody could get behind it and everything. It was, I was very excited when I saw that.
Did you get to use any, you got to use some of these, didn't you, Alex, when you played, when you got?
I've used all the skills in the tree. There are the smart cover is like a really interesting one because, I mean, the fact that you can combine them is like super cool because then suddenly I'll start thinking about which other skills would technically combine as well.
Right.
But I think the smart cover is something that's going to be super useful, especially like in Dark Zone engagements, because you can use it offensively as well as defensively as well. You know, you can put it on, typically you can put it on cover and you can get healing from when you're behind it. But if you throw it on enemy cover, then they take more damage.
Oh,
so if you can
cool.
be like a, if you can be sort of in a position where like, you know, you say, for example, take the Dark Zone where you know that like those guys used to have, stand up on that building opposite the car park.
Right.
And they always hide behind that wall. If you could suddenly put smart cover on that wall, then, and they don't realize it's there, then they're covering behind it, and suddenly they're taking, you know, double damage. Then it's going to be pretty insane.
Oh,
but that,
wow. Yeah. I didn't know it worked the opposite way like that. I always thought about it as a defensive, not as a, I mean, defensive, but as for yourself.
Yeah, okay. there's two team-based mods for it. One heals you, and one, I believe, what is it? Is it an ammo replenisher? I can't remember exactly what the second one is, but there's two of them basically that benefit your team, or there's one which is basically designed so you're putting it on enemies' cover instead.
That's awesome.
But I think one of the cool things as well is that, like, a lot of these skills that, I don't know whether, like, a lot of people realize that, but a lot of the skills can be thrown. So as you say, like, you can throw the shield, you can throw the turret, you can throw the seeker mine.
Yeah.
You can throw, like, the recovery unit. Basically, like, a lot of the skills that you would normally think, you know, like a turret, surely you would place it down. But in actual fact, you can throw them. Yeah. So suddenly, that opens up so many different things. I mean, I was thinking the other day, because from when I was playing in the event, I basically went all medic inside the Dark Zone. Simply because if you have first aid and you've got high enough skill... what's the word I'm looking for? Tech tree. The tech... electronics. That's it. That's the one. Yes, electronics. If you've got a high enough electronic skill, then it will heal three bars, which is effectively a life
bar. It's pretty crazy. I love playing around with the electronics and seeing what how it would change how effective your skills
are. But then if you pair that with... you have healing station, which you can throw on the ground, and while you're standing inside it, you get healed as well. And you've also got recovery link, which is your signature skill, which also heals and revives teammates. So effectively, if I used to run into the Dark Zone in that event with three healing skills. So that way, I've effectively at all times got four life bars. You have the one you go in with, then you start taking damage. You max out with first aid, you take more damage. You max out with recovery link, and then you take more damage. And you max out with healing station. So you suddenly become this like impossible force. Yeah. You know, I'd go up against people and I would run in their face and they would start winning the battle because they're shooting me.
Right.
And I just suddenly heal and they're like, oh wait, he's got a full life bar again, and they're trying to get me down again. And it's it's really interesting to sort of like see how they're going to play out. But I think I almost overlooked, like, during those times, I almost overlooked the damaging skills. But the fact that you can throw a lot of them, like, I'm most interested in the dragon breath mod for the turret, the fire one, because as you guys know, like, if you get set on fire, you can't sprint and you can't heal.
Right.
So if you imagine for a minute that you can throw a turret, if you can throw it behind the enemy and you're in front of them, their instinctive reaction is to run away. But if they're suddenly, if they turn around and they get burnt, then they're going to be, they can't run, they can't heal.
There's many like combinations and variations of these skills. Mm. Like, it's going to make gameplay so much. The Dark Zone is going to be crazy at level 30.
And I think, Alex just made a good point too, that a lot of people right now have some concerns about going solo in the Dark Zone. Well, to be fair, the skills that you played in the beta probably didn't really suit a solo Dark Zone player that well. Yeah. So when you have access to more skills, I think exactly what Alex was saying, there's going to be better loadouts that you can take going solo or as a team that's going to make you more effective in there.
Right.
I think that's a really cool point.
Yeah, for sure. I think one of the other super exciting ones, I mean, again, to that point, if you were going to be a solo player, would be a tank build, because the riot shield has got a really interesting skill whereby if someone's shooting the shield, you get healed for a portion of that damage.
Yeah.
So you can basically, if you spec up in electronics and your shield lasts a lot longer and you walk forward and people are shooting you and effectively healing you, then you're just going to be, maybe you wouldn't necessarily be able to like go up and kill the whole team, but at least it would let you get away. You could run away with that shield and stuff. So it would, there's plenty. Yeah. As you say, I think once you have access to all the skills, there's definitely going to be a lot of, I mean, I saw loads of clips during the beta of people, even with simple like skills, just like good gun skill, running around, just like taking out all teams and stuff. And I think that's one of the important things. I remember before the beta, they said in one of their podcasts as well, they mentioned that weapon, like your skills and your gear and stuff will make up, what is it, about like 40% of your damage, but like 60% will come from like player skill. So
it's
gonna be cool.
There's still that margin.
So there's one other thing that we saw in that video that was a first. I think Doom and Boom noticed it right away.
Yeah,
the UMP-45.
I remember that gun from Modern Warfare 2. I use that gun all the time.
Yep. It's a submachine gun I really, really like. So pretty excited to see that it's in-game.
It's another 45 cal, isn't it?
Yep.
What's another 45 caliber submachine gun?
The Crisp.
Oh, the Vector.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, that's something cool. I mean, I missed that one because I'm not really I don't know guns too well. But one thing that the fact that you said it's an SMG, I weirdly, like, in the beta, I went into it and you know how you make assumptions with weapons. You know, I was like, sniper rifles are great, shotguns are great, assault rifles are great, and I ignored everything else at first.
Yeah.
But then after a while, especially when I realized that the Cassidy had been nerfed to hell.
Yeah.
and I realized that with shotguns, you know, as much as I like them, because I went to them instinctively because of, like, in the alpha, if you had the Cassidy, it was just, you were basically a god in the doctor. But if you miss your shots too much, yeah. But then suddenly someone said something about the MP7. I was like, let me just go and see what this is like. And I got it, and I was like, oh my gosh. Like, bear in mind, in things like Call of Duty, I normally go SMG anyway because I like to, like, run and gun. But right. I just completely, I think it's because I've gone from playing things like Destiny where I know certain weapon types are really good and then I ignore everything else.
Right.
So I made this weird assumption about SMGs, but then suddenly went in with the MP7 and found that it melts health bars. And I was holy crap.
That's what's so cool about it. Like, every gun is good in its own way. You know, like, yeah. I mean, unless it's the Cassidy, which you just have to get, like, right up on someone. And if you hit them in the head, you know, with both shots, you know, you're doing okay. But if not, you're just in trouble. But, you know, every gun was useful in some ways, you know. And some SMGs weren't as good as others. But if you threw, like, an extended mag on there, because I just felt like they threw so many bullets so fast that, you know, a lot of times I ran out of ammo before I could actually kill somebody with them. I ended up, like, switching to my pistol or switching to my assault rifle. But, yeah, I like the MP7. Which one did, Dave, you ran with one, didn't you? What did you run with?
Oh, I can't remember the name of it. I was using the Vector because I got a superior one from the vendor that I really liked.
Yeah.
You were with my sweet teal weapon skin that you guys were jealous of.
I was switching back and forth between the SMG9 and the Type 821. And once I put a vertical grip on the Type 821, you could melt guys with it. And the same thing with the KG9.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, if you can land most all of those shots, you just do ridiculous chip damage to them.
Right.
You know, a single bullet's not going to do a lot, but you're putting so many rounds down range, especially with an extended mag, and if you have some sort of stabilization on it, it's crazy how much you can do.
Yep.
Cool. Let's see, last bit of news. There's a couple real observant YouTubers out there that made a couple videos about another faction that looked like was confirmed in the beta by looking at several different pieces. So the fourth faction, correct me if I'm wrong, but fourth would be the correct way to say it, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Third enemy, fourth confirmed. Is that how you say that? Is called the Last Man Battalion, or the LMB. So both Boomslang and Arekkz put out some videos on there, so I'm just going to run through a couple of the things that we can see in there, and of course the links to their videos will be in the show notes. But the LMB is a private military company, obviously very capable and very serious hardware. Sounds like they were initially sent to Manhattan to protect the rich, and then ended up getting stuck there. So they were hired to protect all the rich people hired them to come in and protect all their loot. That's what it sounded like to me anyway. That was kind of a snippet from the pirate radio show. So if you were in the dark zone and you were in the safe zone, because you kept going back to look at those high-end weapons and make sure you had enough dark zone credits for them, whenever you were in there, you were hearing this pirate radio show. Additionally, there was a small, on the loading screen, you could kind of see, they always had, I can't remember what they would call them there, but certain
tips, kind of.
Yeah, on the tips page where they also had certain personnel or people that you would run into, and they had Lieutenant Colonel Charles Bliss pop up on the screen at one point and kind of went into his background as a military badass, like Doom would say. So what, how do you guys think they're going to play a role? And I know that, Arekkz, actually, you'd played some video, that someone had given you, kind of showing them, kind of getting a visual on them to where, correct me if I'm wrong, somebody had found them. They wandered up, you know, north up into the dark zone to get, was it a level 30 they ran into?
Yeah. So we were, when we were at the event, we were allowed to play with level 20 characters. So we came in about midway through the dark zones, or like the kind of dark zone 3 and 4. But if you venture super far north, to a level 30 area, they wear like white hoods. They've got sort of like, they look almost like assassins from like Assassin's Creed kind of thing. But I've heard, I think the military term, I think they're apparently some military sniper hood. I'm not really kind of like clued up on that. But apparently that's sort of like a sniper, an actual kind of thing they will wear. But yeah, they're all dressed in white. and they are, they've got some serious firepower, but when they speak as well, they have a very kind of like military tongue. They speak tactically and they kind of like, you know, they communicate a lot more and they move a lot. Because that's one of the things I think they spoke about. There was a recent interview as well. People were asking about how in, say, the beta, it seemed like a lot of the enemies were a little bit stupid, but that's because they made the point that for the most part, you're up against rioters and looters who are just right. general thugs. But when you think about how different things will move, you know, the cleaners, again, they're just there to kind of like burn stuff, and they can basically walk forward as almost like a wall because they can just bring fire towards you.
Right.
But then we haven't encountered the Rikers yet. And then, yeah, the LMB, they are, they're just, yeah, they're super tactical. So they'll move as a squad. In fact, in that video, like I put a clip in the video of just one character, which one shots a level 20 player. I mean, they do that not necessarily because the LMB themselves are that powerful, but it's more because they were 10 levels higher than the player.
Right.
But still, they, but if you, the guy that lent me the clip, shortly before that clip in his video, there's an area where there's about three or four of them rolling around, and they move as a unit. So they're definitely going to be a lot more organized when right. you have to go up against them, which will be interesting.
Yeah, because it's the only only military unit you've ever gone up against. Because like you're saying, everyone else you fight is just your random people wandering around. Because the cleaners used to be city sanitation workers, you know, so they don't Correct. Really they don't have any military training or any tactics that they use. So fighting this faction is going to be a lot of fun. Like, I'm interested to see if they, you know, since they are mercenaries or whatever, if they have the same kind of like ability, like if they will have abilities, or like some of the bosses or whatever will have abilities like the agents. I think that would be kind of cool too. Like,
that would be really
imagine
cool,
them like, you know, what are they doing? You see them lay down a seeker mine, it starts chasing you. So that might be kind of cool. But yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised to see that. I mean, we've already seen other characters that deploy turrets and stuff.
Oh, yeah,
so,
that's true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't want to get too far off the topic, because I have one thing to talk about this. When you said Seeker Mine, that reminded me at the end of that Know Your Skills video, you have like a little pet Seeker Mine. A little Seeker Mine was just following them along. Maybe that's your new pet that we keep talking about.
Well, it goes into like a friendly mode or whatever. It's green, and it just follows you until it detects an enemy, and then it chases them down. So you if you're right outside your base of operations and you deploy it, it'll stay with you and then follow you around until you get into a gunfight or whatever.
See, I definitely want one of those to replace my ghost. I've said it once, I'm going to say it again.
That would be awesome. Mines. Dude, that would be cool if you could have like a little tracker thing that you could clip on your belt and it could just follow you around your house. How cool would that be?
So good.
Sign me up. I want one.
Now, one thing I noticed in that in the gameplay that Alex had put up, and it was listening to that pirate radio, and the host on there, he's talking about the LMB, and he mentions that they have tanks. I don't know if you guys heard that or not. It just kind of stuck out to me because they specifically said they're up there with their tanks and stuff. Do you see any potential for that? I mean, could that be a part of... is that something you could see when you're just roaming around in those higher up areas, or as Boom and we've speculated before, could that be part of a mission, you know, or a horde mode or something,
raid,
right? To see a tank in there, just want to see, you know, if they have all this militarized equipment, is that a possibility, or is that just something just out saying on the radio?
I think I'd probably personally say, again, if you look at sort of like the North of the Dark Zone, there's a lot of kind of derelict, but I mean, just pretty much like anywhere else, but it's almost like there's a section where it looks like there's like a big battle that's taken place, because there's this area where you see the LMB and then everything is basically burnt out and destroyed. So I imagine if anything, they might have, it might be like tank remnants. I think it might sort of go against the grain a little bit, given that, you know, you don't have vehicles or anything, if suddenly they came out at you in a tank.
Right.
And you're basically on foot. I mean, but at the same time, you know, they could throw the curveball in, and just suddenly you've got to use, you know, everything you've got to try and take down this thing. But I think it's just like, because they're trying to sort of keep the realism, even though you've got like a sticky bomb or you've got like a small mine, realistically those things would do nothing to a tank.
Yeah.
So I think unless they give you some kind of like rocket launcher, which they obviously don't, I think it's more likely that they've probably got, you know, they're probably like derelict tanks sort of like lying around, because they're supposedly the LMB are using the UN building as sort of like their main base, or the kind of like, that's where they're holding up. I think there's a concept art piece of like the UN building as well, which is, I'm thinking there could be like a big high level activity there, or what I'm hoping are going to be raids.
Yeah, that would be cool.
But yeah,
I don't know. Yeah, like you're saying, it'd be kind of weird for them to just throw a tank in there when you really have no way of fighting it exactly. I mean, now I'm not going to say that. I can't say. No, never mind. There's something I know. I can't say it right now. But anyways, yeah, I think it would be cool if a raid or something with some sort of high end. I don't know about tanks necessarily, but it'd be cool if they had. I mean, we haven't seen like all the kind of technology and stuff. Maybe they have. I don't know. Mech suits. Titanfall, I don't know.
Well, okay, wait a second. Tanks aren't cool, but mech suits are cool.
Yeah.
Where's the line?
So if the cleaners are supposed to use modded out garbage trucks, right?
Yeah.
Are we going to actually see them driving in them, or we're just going to see them parked or whatever?
I doubt we'll see any cars moving, personally. Yeah. I mean, we saw that in that one theatrical trailer, but I don't think... Right. I don't know. I mean, who knows?
Maybe but, in like cutscenes or something.
Yeah, but from the streets I've seen, I haven't seen anywhere where you could really even drive. So,
right.
But we haven't seen the entire map either. So,
they might be able to get away with it out. So, like, for example, I always kind of like think about when I think about these kind of things, I think about something that would work both outside and inside the Dark Zone. But I suppose if you separated it and you had a story mission, then you could probably get away with a bit more. So, for example, if you did have them driving on a truck, because let's say, for example, there's an open area like further north of the PvE zone. And then maybe, you know, they're driving on the truck and that's how you kind of like they enter the scene. Maybe that would make sense. But of course, I wouldn't imagine that would happen inside the Dark Zone. So I kind of that's my only reason for doubting certain things, because I think to myself, whatever they kind of like apply outside should probably apply inside as well.
Right, right.
Definitely. But who knows?
Yeah. So maybe not in the open world, but maybe in some closed off story missions.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah.
Kind of exciting.
Last bit here, I just had some community / RAR news. It's just something cool that I wanted to point out. You know, our official forums are over at, we are hosted by thedivisionforums.com. So you can find our official forums over there and interact with us and kind of get the show notes and all the other things that we're up to. But they also have, obviously, general discussion and news for themselves about the Division. But every month, they do a monthly raffle that's free to join. And they've been raffling off a copy of the game every month.
Wow.
So they just ask that you be active on the forum. So if you're a forum member and you have X amount of posts and active in the community, just trying to generate some community activity in there. So it's a really cool idea. And you'll see a post in there for giveaways every month. Last month and this month, they've done a free copy of the game. So we obviously encourage you to go over there, interact with us on our forums, but also a good place where a lot of members are coming together to participate together. So definitely check them out, and that's at thedivisionforums.com. And then also check us out while we're there.
Cool. All right. Let's go ahead and hear what the fans have to say with listener mail. If you want to be part of Rogue Agent Radio, send us your questions and topics to rogueagentradio@gmail.com, where they will then be answered on the show. Just like Jay Silva, he asks, if you put your speculation hat on, can you have an opinion on how having more than one character would benefit in The Division? P.S. Thinking back how it helped in Destiny. Thanks, guys. It's interesting. So, how do you think having more than one character is going to benefit you? Because in Destiny, you had three different classes. In The Division, you don't have any specific classes. You think it's going to benefit with like material farming or gear farming and things? Because we can swap gear between characters, or at least we could in the alpha. I didn't actually test it in the beta, but supposedly you can still swap. I think you can still swap it. So what do you guys think?
I mean, I don't know.
Go ahead, Alex.
I was thinking, I mean, initially, one of the things people did in the beta was your cosmetic gear library is shared across all characters regardless. So one thing you could do, because when you spawn in or you start the game, it gives you a random set of clothes.
Oh, yeah.
So one thing you could do is as a minor sort of thing, you could use it as a means to farm clothing items, because you basically create a character, delete it, create a character.
Yeah.
But as a wider thing, it's an interesting choice. I mean, it's one of those things where... whenever you have multiple characters, there doesn't necessarily always have to be a benefit. You look at like World of Warcraft, it's got character slots that don't necessarily, I mean, sure, you have like a shared inventory, but really it's just more if you want to play as a different character. Whereas if you like cast your mind back to, you know, a few years ago, multiple save slots is more just if you happen to play with like, you know, your brother or something like that.
Right.
But to apply that to sort of like something more relevant these days, it could well be that, you know, what we don't necessarily know, it could well be that during the game, maybe you have to make choices. Maybe there's some kind of story hook where you know, I mean, the game's around based around factions and stuff. I mean, what if you have to make some kind of choice in game?
Yeah.
Or what if there's kind of like a part in game where, you know, maybe there's blueprints, for example. What if there comes a point where you complete a mission and they're like, hey, here, you can either have a blueprint for this super awesome high-end assault rifle, or you can have the one for the super high-end sniper rifle, but you can't have both.
Right.
So then suddenly you make a second character and you take that blueprint and you craft them both. I mean, that's just sort of like a, you know, something that might happen. But yeah, aside from that, I don't really know, because as you mentioned, you know, there are no classes you can just, you know, swap out and whatnot. So that's kind of what I'm thinking.
Right. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, I haven't seen enough of the game yet to really know what the benefit of having a second character would be, because, you know, you can play however you want on either character, unless like one character you just wanted to go straight up tech on everything and that's all you do, and then the other characters you do all that, but you know, in the end you're eventually going to max out everything anyway, so it doesn't really matter. But yeah, like you're saying, you could farm cosmetic items, just create and delete characters all day long. That would be hilarious. Yeah.
Sorry, Boom, are you still going on that?
Oh, the only thing I really know is, like, if you just want to create a male and a female character just to see the difference, that's what I did.
Here's my nerdy thought on it. So let me make sure I'm thinking of this. So, like, things that you can interchange to make your character classless on the fly. Mm-hmm. So you can change your skills, right?
Right.
You can change your talents.
Yep.
Right? Perks are passive, so you can't change those, right? Or does it matter which ones you... I'm trying to remember on perks, if it's just when you unlock it.
When you unlock it, it's like, it's just
perks that are unlocked permanently, yeah.
Permanently, okay? So we don't have to worry about that. So now we have skills, talents, weapon talents. Those could be changed, right?
Yeah. Weapons in general.
Weapon talents, weapons. And then there's one other thing I was thinking about. Or just mods.
Gear and mods.
So depending on how nerdy you want to min-max a character and how lazy you are, like I am. So if I set up like a healer character to where I have four talents that I always want to use for this healer character, I have this set of skills and mods that I always want to use for this character, I have these types of weapon attachments that's going to specialize my character the most, whether it's all head damage weapon talents, or it's, you know, skill bonus weapon talents,
right?
And then these certain mods that maybe that character, I'm not so much a head damage, but I'm more so, you know, this kind of perk on the gun. If to me, that would be probably the only reason that I can think of, you know, to have two different characters to mess around with those two types of builds and have all those things to switch around. Because the thing that I would get caught up in is if I switch my, say, the only things I'm thinking about my build, oh, then you got to switch all your gear around to min-max your electronics and firearms and health. But just thinking about, okay, if you want to switch to a DPS build, you know, go switch to your four talents and switch all your gear out, you know, and switch all your gear so you're more in firearms, so on and so forth. But I think that's the only really reason I would do that. And since you can share gear between each other in the stash, I could say my other character is my tank build, and any type of things I pick up that has a high health on it, I could put it in there for that character and keep all my firearm stuff for me. Yeah. I don't know.
I think the last thing that it could be beneficial is just extra storage slots. You know, you have so much gear that you just dump everything onto all the three of those characters. And you're like, okay, I need this gun. And you know, instead of...
There's one more thing I was thinking it could be. So there's one thing that I'm hanging on to. Like, I've done a few videos on this, and I'm just like, I'm not letting it go until they actively say to my face, this is not a thing. I still very strongly believe that raids are a thing in Division.
Yeah.
There are so many signs pointing to the fact that they are going to exist. So if they follow conventional raid systems, the other purpose for a third character or multiple characters would, of course, you know, you'll know coming from like Destiny as well, is a weekly lockout.
Right.
All raids, I mean, any game I've played has like a kind of thing, you know, World of Warcraft does it. Once you've done your raid for the week, you can't get loot from it again.
Right.
So if there are raids, you know, in whatever kind of, you know, scope they are, if it fits in this game, maybe you go and raid the UN building and go up against the LMB, defeat the boss, and there's like some really cool loot you can drop.
Yeah.
But once you've done that with one character, you can't replay it again to get loot. So suddenly maybe that's the reason for your multiple characters again, because you then get to the point where, especially when you consider you don't have classes and you can share gear, you know, gearing up would actually be pretty simple. You get yourself to level 30, and just like in Destiny, you know, you pass your gear around, and suddenly character number two is also super super powerful because you passed your gear over. So that could be the other third purpose for having multiple character slots if you're going to have, like, a weekly lockout on content.
Yeah. What if they make it to where it's account-wide? You beat it once on any of your characters, and then you can't farm it. Be like, no! I could imagine that happening, though, for that specific reason. They're probably listening to this now. Oh, shoot, let's put that in the game real quick.
Well, the thing is I think you have a trouble if you just put gear in there. A lower level can't use it right away, right? You still have to be a certain level to even use it. So you really couldn't do, am I thinking about it right? You couldn't do like a quick jump to all, like, all firearms, because you still have to level up your character XP wise just to use the gear, unlike in the Destiny, right?
For trading too.
Yeah.
That's a whole other discussion.
Yeah. But on just on a side note, I did love your video, Arekkz, on the raid thing. So if you guys haven't watched that, that was some pretty sweet detective work on the PC side.
That really
got me going on it. So speculation, but
I'm not letting that go because that's make or break for me, because you know, I want to spend hundreds and thousands, you know, I want to spend like thousands of hours in Division, but ultimately, it all depends on what the end game is like. You know, if we complete the story missions and then the only thing left to do is min-max gear and go in the Dark Zone, then sure, I'll still enjoy it, but there'll be limited things for me to do. But if there's suddenly weekly content, daily content, and raids, then, oh my gosh, I'm talking 3,000 hours.
Yeah, I'm excited about all their expansion passes, too. It'll be pretty cool. Mm. But I'm pretty sure I could spend 100-plus hours just looking at all the walls and the buildings and reading the magazines.
We can contest to that.
They're like, Boomsling, come on, stop looking at that, you know, pile of snow over there. So detailed.
I did bring up the rear a lot because I was looking at my inventory, but Boom was leading us, and he was just looking at everything. I'm like, where are we going? Oh, I just wanted to look at this building. I'm like, dude, let's go do something.
Yeah, that was my description of Dave through the whole beta was in the rear with the gear.
Yeah. Dave, what are you doing? I'm looking at my menu.
Actually, someone made a comment of that on one of my live streams. They were like, every time I tune into this guy's live stream, he's in his menu. I'm like, there's all the stuff to look at.
There's so much to look at, right?
It's fun to just sit around, play with your guns, mod them out, and look how everything changes. I love the inspect, too, how you can zoom in. Oh, yeah. It's so good.
I didn't find the inspect on the player until actually I saw it on saw some of Alex's pictures he was posting. Oh, when you got your weapon skin, you were posting some pictures on Twitter. I'm like, how did he get that view? I didn't know that existed until like the last day.
I saw it by accident at one point. I was like, oh, this is cool.
Yeah.
The more you know. Anyways, we're going to go ahead and move into topic of the week because we're already an hour into this thing. But anyways, this week we are going to talk about the perks that are in the Division. Perks are passive abilities that you unlock by unlocking certain upgrades in your base. Each base has the three wings. Yeah, all the perks are in wings too, just like the talents and the skills, right, Alex?
Yes,
that's what I thought. Okay, so with these perks, same thing. We're gonna do the same thing that we did with talents. Sorry. We'll each read. All three take three different ones, and then like if there's an interesting one, we'll stop and talk about it. Who wants to go first?
I got it. I'll go first. Okay. Unfortunately, I'm going to do the medical tree, and there's not as exciting as perks as there are in some of the other trees. But I'll start off there.
Before we start, like this is a really good way to go ahead and get out your pen and paper, everybody. This is what you need to know. When the Division comes out, these are things that are going to help you. Like Alex mentioned it in a tweet a little while ago. Like there are certain perks in here that like help you level up faster, give you more inventory slots. My southern accent came out right there. no, that was accident. So you'll be able to mark down which one of these you want to go after in each of your wings in your base, which upgrades that you're going to purchase in order to help you. So there's a lot of things to consider, not only talents and skills, but also perks and how your actual character, like perks are what are going to define the major differences between a low level agent and a high level agent. Like a low level agent is not going to have it's not going to be as powerful and be able to carry as many things and have all of these experience, whatever. I haven't even read through all of them, but that's what's exciting to me. Like all the other ones, you know, everyone can have a little bit different and it won't really matter. But once you get to be higher level, you're obviously more powerful, which is what I like. So anyways, continue.
Yeah, and just to be, all of this will be on my spreadsheet. I think I'm talking about my spreadsheet too much now because I'm starting to get, there's a lot of expectations out there.
We got an email about it. Someone's like, a couple of people like, oh, I have spreadsheets too.
And I can't get it out there until I confirm it all. So I can't confirm half of it. But so just bear with me, guys. You'll have your character builder spreadsheet, but I got to confirm everything. But you would be able to use the spreadsheet to kind of pick which perks best suit your character so you can kind of get a map from the character you want to build. So anyway, medical perks. So as Boom mentioned, so you have your wing and there's 10, I'll say 10 missions. I think missions, 10 upgrades is what I want to say. Mm-hmm. 10 upgrades in your wing. Each part of that upgrade costs you so many supplies depending on the wing. So in this case, talking about the medical wing, you need medical supplies to upgrade those areas of the wing, which we'll talk about. And you can do those in any order that you want. So if you want a particular perk attached to a particular upgrade, you can upgrade that one and not have to do it progressional. So it's not linear, right? Mm. So the first perk, and there's three of these perks in three different places. So the first perk is called med kits. So if you get the med kits perk, it just increases your med kit inventory by one slot. So I think you can have two to start, right?
I think so.
And then there's three more of these med kit perks within the medical tree, so then you could pretty much run around with five to six med kits, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that counts for three. And then on here it says, you know, example would be if you unlock the clinic, you get a med perk. If you unlock pediatric care, you would get a med kit. And then there was one more. If you unlock intensive care, you would also get a med kit. Mm-hmm. Another one is called protective measures. This increases your virus protection by one, gaining access to higher level contaminated areas. So that's pretty cool. So I'm assuming when I read this, it says, you know, if you're a level 9 and you need to get into a level 10, this would actually give you that one bump to get into a level 10. Is that how you guys would read that?
Yeah, contaminated areas are level 1 through 4, I think it is. And so this would upgrade your mask to enable you to, like if you're level 1, if you unlock the virus lab, you would now have a level 2, so filter or whatever it would be. So you would then be able to access that level 2 contaminated area.
Well, that makes sense because then there's three of these. So this is how you upgrade your mask is by perks.
Yeah. So then you would be able to access that one room in Madison Garden mission and not die.
No matter how many times you try to loot
I got in
that
there and
chest,
opened it
you
once.
You can't do it. Yeah.
It has two blue items. I know that.
Yep. I got it. I got in there once and looted it.
Yeah. Yep. And we watched you die.
Yep. Yeah.
So there's three of those in the medical tree. So if you unlock all three of those, then you'd be able to enter into areas with a level 3 contaminated area level 3. So the next one, see, like my medical ones aren't as exciting. You guys have the more exciting ones, but the other one is canned food. Okay, great. Canned food.
Woo!
It gives increased canned food effect by 10 seconds. Which one, what does the canned food do? I use the other ones pretty frequently, but what's the canned food do? Do you guys remember?
Canned food was the one that increases your healing effects. So if you use a med kit, it gives you a better heal.
Yeah. Okay.
So it's actually pretty useful.
Yeah, it is pretty useful. Yeah, they're all pretty useful. Like, I just forget that they're there.
Yeah, yeah, no, yeah. I feel like a lot of people forgot all of the consumables and stuff. Like, oh, wait, yeah, I have flaming bullets. I'm going to put that on.
I used the energy bars quite a bit when some of my teammates would accidentally flashbang me. It was very, very convenient to use. So the next one's called supplier. These types of ones are really cool, and these are the types of perks that remind me of passive abilities that remind me of true RPGs, MMOs. So this is called supplier. We will collect canned food, water, energy bars, and soda in the supply line once per hour.
That's interesting because that brings me back to E3 2014 when it shows the base, you know, when it zooms out and it has all the different little perks on it. One of them was supply line. One of them, and then other ones were like armory and trade station and stuff, but whatever. So that's kind of cool that that's still, it's in the game in some form.
Yeah, and just to be clear, so that's just some invisible person that's running around collecting goods for you and putting it back in your base of operations so that you can always, which I don't understand how that works, though, if you can...
That actually makes more sense now, because I remember if in the alpha, I don't know, did all you guys play the alpha?
I did,
two of the three of us did.
One of the simple things is that when you go to your restock crate in the alpha, it's used to give you everything, whereas in the beta, it would only give you ammo, med kits, and... I think that was pretty much it. So of course
did
that now explains
grenades?
Where gave you grenades, that's it, the base grenades. But that now explains when you mentioned that it gives you the supply line, it now means that when you have the supply line in place, going to your restock crate will now also give you consumable items. So that's how you can get to the point where going to that restock crate will then give you everything.
That's pretty cool.
Versus giving you, which is really cool. Yeah. Because I wondered why when I was in the base, I was like, why is this giving me like next to nothing?
Yeah.
And that's
why. These guys are really skimping on me here.
Yeah.
So I gotta start cracking the whip around here and get people making more stuff for me.
Where you guys hiding all the candy bars?
Next one is called Contamination Intel. This will reveal all contaminated areas on the map. So that's pretty cool.
I think we unlocked that in the beta, didn't we?
I don't think so. Because the other one wasn't it quarantine in the other map? In the beta, what was the second one? It was Clinic, and then was it called Quarantine, the second unlockable?
That's what this one
yes.
is.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, sorry. You're right. That is Quarantine. Yeah, very smart of you. Yes, so the unlockable was Quarantine, so that is the one we unlocked. I guess I never realized that there was a perk tied to it. I was just waiting for the skill mods.
Yeah.
Didn't even check to see if there was a perk.
Perks, poor perks are getting forgotten.
I know.
I'm important too.
Let's see, protective measures we talked about. Here's the one I'm looking for. Here's the one that Alex is looking for too. Hazardous materials. Increase your dark zone inventory by one slot.
That'd be good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Nice.
Yeah, and I noticed that we talked about the gentleman's rogue last week on the episode. And if you watched Eric's in his videos, I would consider him the gentleman's rogue because he always said he was sorry after he downed some some random person. And just he's like, "Oh, I'm sorry." So
that's what voice the proximity wipe just makes that so much worse. Because
yeah.
I don't know if you saw in that video, like I was all right. I mean, obviously I was saying sorry, but the second I killed someone and they were actually like, no, please don't. Oh, and suddenly that made me like, I was super aware of my consciousness. And I was like, oh, I feel super bad. I went off trying to help people.
Yeah.
I know. It's one thing I always say, a joke. I like to know that I'm making other people sad on the other end of that controller. But when you actually hear it, it's a little more, unsettling when you hear it. So.
There was the one kid that we kept killing. And every time he's like, dude,
really?
I don't have anything.
Like he was a 10-year-old kid.
Yeah.
Like, I almost feel bad.
But actually,
hopefully he comes back. Hopefully he comes back in the dark zone. I don't want to discourage anybody.
He probably listens to this podcast. He's like, these guys are making fun of me.
So next one is called Rigor. And this is, someone runs out, it's collect fabrics in your medical wing once per hour.
So I wonder if you go up to like Jessica Candle or whatever, and she's like, oh, here's some fabrics. Or if it's in a box in there or something. I can't wait to see like what the base looks like maxed out. What's going to be in there? You know, like we talked about like the shooting range last week or whatever, because there's so many spaces in there that are blocked off and wide open. So
there's the one guy that's kind of in the middle in the back that, what was it, rewards
claim officer
or something. Reward vendor.
Yeah.
Right. So what is he going to have this stuff, or is that something completely different?
He's where you go to get your like beta rewards, for example, or if there's anything you get as like a Uplay reward or like some kind of promotional thing, or you know, like the community intelligence site as well.
So he's like a postmaster in Destiny.
Okay. Or
yes, exactly. Yeah.
Or your tests or whatever.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Awesome. Okay. Cool.
Okay, and then credit. I think we all talked about this one. Well, actually, this is kind of a parent to the other one, but this one is called credit. You unlock this by doing the counseling upgrade, but it'll increase all of your credit gains by 10%.
I feel like there's like a backstory behind why they put credit under counseling. It's like, all right, you need to have to sit down and have a talk so you can learn how to manage your finances. Like,
that's pretty. You're just stretching your dollar out, your dark zone credit out, right? And then the last ones in the medical tree was the last unlockable is if you do all of the upgrades in your medical tree, then you increase your active talent slots by one, which is huge.
Yeah.
That'd be awesome. Yeah, that's gonna be big.
I can't. So that'd be five talents instead of four. So that would do all of your medical perks that you could get.
All right, Doom. Which ones do you want?
I'll take security. Okay. Do you want me to go on with that, or do you want to do tech?
Yeah, you go on with the security, and then I'll do tech after you.
Okay, cool. All right, so under the security tree, the first one is experienced agent. Increased XP gained from all activities by 10%.
Yep, that's probably the first one you want to go after if you want to level up fast.
Yep, that's what I'll be doing. I like a lot of the security perks, so that's probably, of course, the one I'm going to be doing first. So, and you get that by the upgrading the situation room.
Right.
And so the next one is grenades. Increase the grenade inventory by one slot by upgrading the armory. So, I used grenades a lot.
Yeah.
So,
they're really handy.
Yeah.
I hate once the frag grenades, freaking bleeding crazy.
Yeah. I will use them more when they give you the full release. I'm sure they'll give you the ability to change where it's mapped. So I'll be using them more.
Once I got the technique of throwing them down, I'm still not a huge fan of how you deploy them, but I did get used to it. So the next one is advanced weaponry. Unlock advanced weapons vendor in the security wing.
Ooh, okay.
Is that specialist or like superior weapons, or is that going to be high-end weapons?
I don't know. That would be interesting if you did unlock the ability.
I hope we don't have high-end weapons in the base, honestly.
I hope you don't. I want those to be super rare.
Yeah.
Yeah, but would it be, I hate to bring up his name, but would it be Xur in your base of operations? Because if you think about it, in the dark zone, there's only one guy in the dark zone, one vendor in the safe house that sold high-end weapons. So are advanced weapons high-end weapons, and now you can buy them in your base of operations too?
Aren't there going to be multiple safe houses with those guys, or is there just that one?
Yeah, there are multiple safe rooms. Yeah, I don't know whether it's going to be whether they rotate, whether, for example, you have to go and loop around the dark zone trying to find where they are at that time, or whether each of them sells something different. I don't think they'll all sell high-end weapons, but I think the important thing to kind of is to bear in mind is that while some high-end weapons will be available to be sold, I don't think they're going to sell. I don't think it'll be like Xur, where at some point he could sell every single weapon in the game. I think when you also bear in mind that I think the vendor in the base operations will probably only sell superior weapons, given that you have the ability to craft and you can craft high-end weapons.
Mm-hmm.
So I think because, for example, when I played in the level 20 area, if you go to some of the safe houses which are outside the dark zone, they also have vendors in, and if you go to, say, a vendor in the level 20 area, they sell specialized and superior weapons.
Right.
So I think, when you jump around, it's probably more likely going to be a specialized superior weapon vendor in the base operations, which kind of makes it more relevant, because if you at the beginning of the game, they sell like level 5 and 6 weapons.
Yeah.
And if it suddenly gets to the point where when you get to level 20, the base operations is effectively pointless to you.
Right.
So I guess it's kind of a way to make it relevant again.
Yeah. Yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah, that's the way I hope it works. And yeah, I hope there are high-end weapons that only come from certain missions or from certain areas.
Right.
Yeah.
that's what I'm hoping for. That way, when you see somebody with a weapon, you know where they got it from.
Yeah.
Yeah. And real quick on Xur, sorry, bless your heart, Alex, for being able to make a Xur video every week for the last year and a half, because I would jump off of a building if I did that. So bless your heart. Thanks for doing it.
That's all right. No, it's one of the constants I can have when Destiny's boring. At least Xur will be there every single week.
Right. So there's one video you can make every week for Destiny.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And people forget that new people play this game all the time. And Xur is very important to those new people. And yes, I've been first day player, so it's different for me. But
All right. So the next one is combat veteran. Increase XP gained from accolades by 25%.
What's an accolade?
I think that's like at the end of an encounter or whatever, how you have those awards pop up. It says headshot, team effort or something like that. It's not like as you perform the headshot. It's like once things calm down a little bit, and then they pop up and it says like 25 XP, headshot mastered. You know, so many like XP rewards or whatever at the end of that fight. So I think
for,
that's
for each individual firefight that you you're in.
Okay. Yeah, for each individual. Because I think if it popped up in every single one, it would be a little distracting. Like boom, headshot, Call of Duty. You know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Well, I hope they track that. Hope their stats to show all those accolades that they give you. You know.
Yeah, that would be really cool. I want there to be a full stat system. That'd be awesome.
Yes, me too.
Yeah. So the next one is hazardous materials. Increase dark zone inventory by one slot.
So that's seven so far, or eight. Yep, my bad.
Eight. Yeah. The next one is black market vendor. Unlock dark zone fund purchases in the base of operations.
Interesting. So you just have a.
Dark zone vendor
in your base.
Yeah,
that's what it looks like. Yeah.
Can you guys? Go ahead, Alex.
No, I was gonna say, did it say unlock dark zone fund purchases, or did it say unlock dark zone?
Oh yeah, dark zone fund purchases.
Because I wonder if that means there's a conversion. I wonder if you can convert in-game credits to dark zone credits.
Probably.
Or whether it means there'll be a dark zone. Because I wonder whether it would be a bit weird to have a dark zone vendor.
Yeah.
Outside the dark zone, because given that all the different checkpoints have different vendors, so it kind of like makes them. But if it was a currency conversion system, that could be really cool, because of course the people out there that maybe can't open a chest, or they keep, because if you think about it this way, the game never like incentivizes you to go rogue, but if you do go rogue, or you know, you go rogue on people, you take their money. So if the game has a system to reimburse you with that money, because if you can convert what you already have into dark zone funds, suddenly it makes like outside the dark zone even more relevant,
right? Because then you could technically go in and still buy the guns without going into the dark zone and killing people.
Yeah,
because it does say unlock dark zone fund purchases, so you're basically buying the funds. So
yeah, I do like that idea. That would be a cool way to make people able to do that. The conversion rate would be really cool. The only reason that I think that it might be an actual vendor is just because the perk is called black market vendor. But
fair enough.
But if I would definitely be in favor of a conversion rate. That would be cool. The next one is clothes vendor. Unlock a clothes vendor in the base of operations.
Buy cosmetics.
Huzzah!
Nice.
Yeah. Yes.
Yep, I wonder if that's where our camos will be.
Yeah, that could be
maybe
cool.
Yeah,
but also that way Dave doesn't have to spend, you know, hours searching for his tight pants.
Yeah.
Yes. I know. My second character, I never got the skinny jeans. I was so upset because it was on a different console. Yeah.
Oh, but, no.
By my skinny jeans.
I seriously thought you were a female character.
Because I look good.
Yeah. Like, Alex, he ran by me, and I thought Dave was a female character. And I looked at him again. He was a male character. I was like, whoa.
Oh, come on,
Steve. Those are some really tight pants. Anyways.
And the next one is explosive bullets. Increase explosive bullets effect duration by 10 seconds.
I'm excited about this one because I've always thought that, like, the incendiary rounds and the explosive rounds, like, you have to activate them and then use them almost instantly, you know, to get the maximum effect out of them. I almost wish that you could activate them and then they wouldn't start ticking down until you, like, shot.
Yes.
That would be better, in my opinion.
I wish it was just, like, a magazine's worth. Like, because you don't, whenever you activate them, it does the reloading action. Doesn't it do that? Might not do that, but... yeah, if it was just like a magazine or two's worth, that way you just have that until they're out.
Yeah.
You know, not, with it not being a timed thing. That I would prefer that, but yeah. So the next one is gunsmith. Collect weapon parts, crafting materials in the security wing once per hour.
Nice.
Next one is scavenger. Collect items from the scavenger box in the security wing once per hour.
Items? Just like random items that you collect?
Yeah, it must be, because initially I thought it would be like one box for the whole base of operations, where if you have these perks that you get once per hour, typically like in an RPG or MMO, if you have these passive abilities, there'd be like one location to where if all your peeps are farming for you, they would put them in this box. But since all the other ones say, like the one before that, collect weapon parts in the security wing once per hour. That leads me to believe, unless there's a scavenger box in each wing, then there's just one that...
Yeah. Dang, I just saw one of these perks in here, and it basically just confirmed what you were thinking, Dave.
Yeah, okay.
We'll get to it in a minute, but I was reading down through it and was like, oh, cool. Anyways, continue.
The next one is incendiary bullets. Increase the incendiary bullet effect duration by 10 seconds. So just like the explosive bullets.
Right.
Nice.
The next one is special ammo. Collect incendiary and explosive bullets in the supply line once per hour.
Cool. Dude, there's so much stuff in this game.
Yeah.
Hashtag no content. I mean...
right.
This is crazy.
Right. The next one is shooting range. Train in marksmanship at the shooting range.
So yeah, there is a shooting range in the base of operations, which is going to be cool because you'll be able to test out like your damage and your critical hit chance and headshot damage and stuff on all your weapons without having to go out and like shoot a rat or something to figure out how much damage you're doing.
So that just opens up a shooting range that you can go do. It's not going to affect your stats or your any actual character numbers or anything.
Yeah, what is marksmanship? Because I noticed it had a capital M. I'm just going to be real picky on it, but it says, what is marksmanship? It says train in marksmanship. Is that some kind of separate stat or something? Or
personally, I think it's just an area where you can go in and shoot your guns and figure out how much damage you're doing, play around with different builds and things.
Yeah, I think Mass Effect 2 had something like that where you could go in and there was just a shooting range. You could rent different guns and just go try them out.
I think that would be cool.
So, yeah, that would be cool. So you could just go test them.
So. That'll make people who make YouTube videos about gun reviews make it a little easier.
Yeah.
recoil spreads and stuff.
Yeah, that would definitely make it easier instead of me having to go out and shoot the side of a truck.
Yeah.
To get a fire pattern. The next one is Intel Discovery. When completing all side missions and encounters in a named zone, reveal all undiscovered intel on the map.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, not the canine unit. So it's basically like having a dog that goes out and explores for you that we kept talking about.
Right.
You're like, oh, we already solved it. I wish I would have read these.
Yeah. And we have another hazardous materials. Increase dark zone inventory by one slot. So that brings us to 9
cool.
Dark Zone inventory slots. Nice. And the next one is Collector. Increase scavenging by 15%. And that's if you build all of your upgrades.
Sweet. I wonder what scavenging is. If that's just like finding things in the world or what?
Is it just random stuff? Just random upgrade materials and canned food and all of the consumables?
It might random be. I think it's probably going to be the items that you can find, like, you know, you can find things like electronics and basically crafting materials or anything you can kind of like pick up or collect and stuff.
Cool.
All right. That's all of the security perks.
And finally, for the tech wing, number one is inventory. Increase inventory by 10 slots. Unlock control room, and you will get that. That's going to come in handy because, you know, some backpacks change your inventory slots, but just adding 10 in general would be really cool.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Hazardous materials, increase dark zone inventory by one slot, so we're up to 10. Required communications. Division tech materials is number 3. Convert division tech crafting materials into other materials at the crafting station. It's required division tech. So if you have a ton of division tech, you can turn into weapon parts, I guess. So, number four, engineer, collect electronics in the tech wing once per hour. That is also division tech required. Number five is soda. Increase soda consumable effect duration by 10 seconds. Required generators. What did soda do? I can't remember.
Was that the increased... That wasn't increased damage to elites. That was water.
Water.
Oh, soda.
Soda is... Man, I can't remember what soda was.
Come on, Alex. What is soda?
What was it again?
People are like yelling at their podcast right now.
I just listened to the Bombshell Jackets where they talked about all of these, and now I can't remember.
Dang it. Soda. Anyways, whatever it is. Number six, water. Increase water consumable effect duration by 10 seconds. Required water purification. So, let's see here. Number 7, craftsmen collect tools in the tech wing once per hour, required field engineering. Number 8, energy bar, increase energy bar effect duration by 5 seconds. Central heating is required for that. Number 9 is resource assessment, reveal all division tech crafting nodes on the dark zone map. So I guess you'll be able to find out where all your dark zone tech is, or division tech is. Required stat comms. Number 10, stat switch. Unlock item stat switching at the recalibration station.
So that sounds like re-rolling weapons and re-rolling gear. Is that is that what we think?
Yeah. Or like they said that. Oh, sorry. Go on.
No, you go ahead.
They said that you can have, like, you know, you might have, say, let's take the MP7 for example, and if you have like a superior version of that, there might be like 10 different variations of that because they've all got different weapon talents.
Yeah.
So that means if you re-roll it, you know, for example, I had one which was, it had like a really good perk for critical damage, but it also had like a less so good perk for, what was it, something about like, cooldown, something like that, which wasn't that really that useful for that particular gun. So it'd be nice to be able to say, all right, you know, I'm going to re-roll it and potentially get like a perfect roll. So that would be cool.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Sweet.
It seems like they thought of everything. Like,
yeah,
I was like, they should have put this in there. Oh wait, they did. They should have put. Oh, they did. They did put that in there. Number 11, dark zone funds, increase looted dark zone fund gains by 10%.
Ah, nice.
Required is recharge center, and then the final one is stash. Increase stash by 10 slots. You have to build all your upgrades, and then you will get that. Holy crap!
I didn't notice there was a limit on stash. I guess I didn't look.
I think it's 30. Yeah, there is. Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's 30, so it'd be up to 40.
Well, by far the security tree is the coolest.
Yeah, I think so too. I agree. I'm excited about being able to shoot my guns inside of the base because that'll solve a lot of problems when it comes to like. You know, building out your character and figuring out how much damage you're actually doing and stuff. So,
yeah.
Anyways, let's go ahead and move into the final segment, which is the gun review. Alex actually has to go. So I want to take this time to just thank you for joining us. This has been an awesome having you on the show, being able to talk about the game. Yeah, definitely. Where can people find you? Where can people find you, like, on the interwebs?
Main place is youtube.com/ArekkzG, sort of Arekkz Gaming, and then of course also twitter.com/Arekkz. They are probably the best places to find because then you can stay up to date with all the latest and whatnot.
Cool Awesome. Well, thank you again for being on the show. This has been awesome. Too bad you can't stick around for the gun review, but we'll have you on again. How about that? We'll make up for
it. I'll definitely be back.
Yeah. All right, man.
All right, thanks, Alex. Appreciate it.
Thanks, guys. Take care.
Take care. See you. All right. So for the gun review, we are going to talk about the ACR, right?
Yeah. I just took your spot.
I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. This is the first one where I've done the actual real world review. And so now we're going to do the in-game review.
Things are changing.
Yeah. I just thought I'd put it up in the poll, and it pretty overwhelmingly won. Yeah. Coming in second was the M1A, which I think is what we're going to do next week because that ended up being my favorite overall gun.
Yeah.
But so I'm just going to do a brief overview of the real world review that we did. If you want to hear the actual review, you can go back. I can't remember which episode it was, but it was a few back where we talked. You know, I did the full on review, but it's the ACR stands for Adaptive Combat Rifle. Adaptive Combat Rifle. It's the production name for an updated version of the Masada Adaptive Combat Weapon System. Hmm. Basically, it's a gun that they took a bunch of different pieces of other guns. So the short stroke gas system from the Armalite AR-18, the upper receiver and charging handle location from the FN SCAR, the liberal use of polymer components from the H&K G36 or the XM8, and the M16 and the AR-15's trigger pack and fire control group. So it's a hybrid of a bunch of different guns to try to create the most efficient, best assault rifle they possibly could.
Right.
So how did we feel about it in game? I know we got really excited when we found the superior version of it. So, like, boom, I know you were super excited. This is the gun that you were searching for the entire time. So,
yeah.
How did you feel about it?
I liked it. I mean, it was ridiculously accurate. Like, a lot of the other assault rifles seemed to bounce around a lot, and you couldn't really control where the bullets were hitting and stuff, even if you put grips on them. Some of them, I mean, for the most part, they all behaved kind of similar, but right. The ACR was definitely the most accurate. It was like a laser gun. I mean, especially right. when you put a grip on it, it was just ridiculous.
Right.
If
you put one of these on and then you switch to an AK-47, you definitely notice the difference.
Oh, yeah.
Because the AK fires like a real AK does.
Yeah.
It does a ton of damage, but it just goes everywhere. There's no accuracy to it at all.
Right.
The next most accurate, easy to use one was the Police M4, but this one was definitely superior to that.
Yeah.
The ACR was. Dave, did you get a chance to use the ACR at all?
I believe so. Is that the one? I mean, I bought the superior version. I'm trying to remember, you know, because I find one, I go shoot it, and then if I like it, I like it. I don't pay attention to the names as much as I probably should. But you know, we did a live stream. Was that the one that had the recoil pattern that was straight up?
Yeah. I think so. Yeah.
Okay. Yep. That was the one that I really enjoyed. So I know, because I don't like the horizontal sway. You know, I can't. Right. I'm not good at controlling a horizontal sway when I have a gun. That's just not me. So I know on that particular one, I could shoot for the chest or the neck, and if I shot for the high chest or neck, I could burst fire it and get my headshots. That's mm-hmm. the kind of gun that it was. I didn't have to worry about it going off to the right. So I did like that gun a lot.
Right, and I know this one, it didn't. Go ahead. Sorry.
No, and I know I've heard a couple other people say that they really enjoyed this one, and they said that it just melts people. Mm-hmm. However, everybody's got to remember, melting people doesn't necessarily mean the gun itself, right? Because it goes back to your DPS. But mm-hmm. anyway, I really did enjoy this gun. It felt good in my fake hands.
Yeah, that is something that's good to keep in mind. You know, unlike a lot of other games, the base damage of the weapon isn't necessarily the most important thing. It's how you have yourself, you know, statted out. So most of the time I ran around with my stamina boosted up and my DPS wasn't quite as high, so I wasn't doing nearly as much damage. But Boom had his firearms, you know, almost maxed out the entire time as much as he could, and he was just doing a ton of damage. So it gets really weird when you're trying to compare weapons, because it really depends on how your stats are, you know, are arranged.
Right.
So, but this one, it did a decent amount of damage, but it was, you know, noticeably more stable. And like you talked about the horizontal stability, I have a couple pictures here in our doc that we're looking at. And I don't know, Dave, if you can throw these up on the website under this episode so people can see. I have a stripped down version, then I have the version that's as fully modded as I could get it with the best mods that I had at that time. And I have all the mods I have on there are mostly to control horizontal stability. So the suppressor that I have on there, you can see is +9% to horizontal stability. And then the hand stop I have on there, I can't remember exactly how much it was, but it did a considerable boost to horizontal stability. And it pretty much was a laser beam.
Yeah.
You know, all you had to do was just kind of control the muzzle rise just a little bit, and you didn't even necessarily have to burst fire. You could just full auto it, and just with a little bit of control, you could just pretty much melt people with it. I mean, it does quite a bit more chip damage than a submachine gun does.
And it just looks so good.
Yeah.
It's a sexy assault rifle.
I got one I'll put on Twitter that's teal. That it was my baby when I used it. Doom, do you think this could... Is this one of those assault rifles that fits any type of quote-unquote class? Like if you're going to play for DPS or, you know, or is this just dependent on range and rate of fire? I found myself trying to pick one that best suited my play style. Is this one that can kind of fill all of them, or is this something...
I would say out of all the guns that we got to use in the beta, this is probably the best all around. It could fit anybody's play style, I would say. You know, of course, there's the sniper rifles and stuff that are going to fit one specific type of play style. There's the submachine guns that fit the run and gun style. But this one is just, you know, it's a good workhorse gun. You know, it's going to do good in pretty much any situation, depending on how you mod it out. So it's definitely the best of the assault rifles that we've seen so far.
Yeah, I definitely enjoy using it. I can't wait to see what like a high end version of one of these looks like. I want to if I get a named ACR in the full game, I'm gonna be happy.
Yeah, yeah, it's definitely a lot better than the SCARs that we found, because there was the SCAR L and the SCAR H, and one was basically a marksman rifle, a single shot, and then the other one was a full auto. And I didn't care for either one of those too much. Even the high end one, because the high end assault rifle, that was a SCAR, right? If I remember right.
Yeah, the Caduceus.
Yeah. So I didn't care for that gun very much.
I didn't
much.
Either. I didn't really like it. It bounced around too much for me, even with like a grip on it.
Yeah. Yeah. I bought it and I was like, oh, yeah, well, that's I mean, it had a lot of talents and everything on it, but it just didn't feel that great. This was the best feeling assault rifle.
Yeah, I agree.
And you can hear Doom's review on episode 3. He did a long review on that, and
I'll put that early.
Yeah, that early. So I don't know if you want me directing people back to episode 3 or not, but I'll put a link into the show notes. If you go back that far, we're encouraging it. Just see how far we've came.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Hear me stumbling over my words even more than I do now. I know that we got a comment. I can't remember exactly which platform we got it on, but we got a comment recently about that we can get a little monotone sometimes, and it's like, well, you know, I would yell a little bit more like some other podcasts do, but I live in an apartment and I don't want to bother my neighbors. Yes. So, you know, sorry about being a little monotone when I get to talking about this. But
I don't like people shouting at me when they're podcasting.
Yeah,
I'm listening and they're like yelling at me. I'm like, I didn't do anything.
Yeah. We're not in a sound studio like some other super high end podcasts. So,
Of us have kids sleeping. Some of us have
things going on. I guess what I'm saying is deal with it.
Finally, you just came out and said it. I was waiting. Gosh.
Yeah. But see, this is your break because you sing vocals in like a heavy rock band, right? I don't say heavy rock, but so this is your break, right? You got to rest your vocals.
Okay. Oh yeah, yeah. No, I'm waiting for the show where we come in like the very next day or even same day that I've done either a band practice or a show where you really get to hear. It doesn't really mess with my voice that much, but you can definitely hear it sometimes.
Hey guys, what's up?
I've been doing it for so long that it really doesn't affect my throat anymore, but every now and then you can tell.
Nice. Ladies and gentlemen, that's going to do it for episode 17 of Rogue Agent Radio. We want to remind you to check out rogueagentradio.com, where you can find links to all of our podcasting wares, whether it's iTunes, Podbean, or Twitter. It's not really on YouTube, although we hope to upload some videos there sometime soon. I think Dave has some stuff in mind. But anyways, if you're hungry for more Tom Clancy talk, then check out Amos's Gaming and their podcast dedicated to Tom Clancy's Rainbow Six Siege, Siege's show. If you want to keep up with all the hosts of Rogue Agent Radio between episodes, you can follow us on Twitter. Dave is at Deep Fried Dave. Doom is at Blessed Doom. And yours truly is at Boomslang. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, maintain radio silence and watch your corners, agents.
Rogue protocol initiated.